Good morning, Grace Church. We are so glad you're here. I want to invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word, if we could. Let's stand together for the reading of God's Word. This is from Psalms 145, starting at verse 8. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all. His compassion is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord. All your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power. And the people of God said, let's worship together. The Father speaks those who worship him in spirit and in truth. We'll sing some great truths this morning. Amen.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, if there is only one foundation, we believe, coming back. Jesus, our Savior. I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ, the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Coming back to our seats, good morning. We are so glad you're here. For those of you joining us online, we want to ask a favor of you. If you would just hit the like button and subscribe, drop us a comment, let us know where you're watching from, and we will send you a free digital gift. It's a subscription to Right Now Media, so we're glad you're watching online. Folks, just a couple of things to be made aware of in the life of the church. First and foremost, pray for the kids in Tampa to NYC. I think they had a little bit of a bus issue, but it'll be fixed by the end of the day. So parents, worry not. Your kids will be home on time. And the parents said amen. Crickets, crickets. Okay, never mind. Next week, we have a potluck. I don't want to mention Pastor JJ and family's name, but somebody has been with us for a year at that point, and we're going to celebrate what God is doing in our midst, and we're going to celebrate the fact that God sent them to us. So, potluck after church next Sunday. If your last name is A through M, we're going to ask that you bring a main dish and a side. If you're N through Z, we're going to ask that you bring a main dish and a dessert, unless your last name is Brown, at which point we want you to bring two desserts. Amen, Pat?
Yes.
Amen? We got an amen on that one? Okay. The weekend after that, on July 23rd, we have a missionary coming to speak with us. I believe they're in the Asia South Pacific, so that's going to be an amazing service, and we invite you to come and check that out as well. Finally, on July 30th, we are going to have, in the evening, we are hosting the Memphis Zone Rally, and William Castellanos and his church are going to lead worship for us, Spanish and English. We'll also have the DS come and give us a word, and that's going to begin at 6 p.m. Also that Sunday, we've got the breakfast buffet going on, and then finally, the following Monday, or tomorrow actually, kids camp begins. So a lot going on in the life of our church, a lot to pray about. While you're praying for the life of our church, if God lays it on your heart to cut grass, I'm sure we would really appreciate that. Amen. At this point, we want to invite the ushers to come forward as we continue our worship and offerings. You know, this isn't just to pay the bills. This is an act of obedience unto the Lord. Amen. There's several ways to give. You can give in the plates if you're an introvert or don't have your checkbook ready. We've got some boxes in the back that you can drop. You can also give online if you go to gracenaz.org/gift. Or if you're really tech savvy and you've got one of those smartphone thingies, you can take a picture there of the QR code and it'll bring you to the website to do that. Church, let's pray over this offering together. Lord, you're amazing. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can call upon the name of Jesus like we've been singing all morning. And Father God, I just pray that you take this gift and bless the giver and multiply this for your glory and for your honor. Lord, you have placed Grace Church in this town for such a time as this. Father God, let this go to joining you on your mission to free the captives, to proclaim good news, to heal hearts, to heal lives, and to bring all the sons and daughters to glory. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Lost are saved. Find their way at the sound of your great name. All our end finds their shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that slayed us, Son of God.
Let's stand together and sing this out.
All the weak find their strength at the sound of your. slave for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your name, Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Your great name.
The people of God said,
the name of Jesus, that we are invited into his presence. You may have a seat. So we are called to the presence of the Lord this day. There are many burdens that we carry with us. I wanted to let you know of just one thing that we found out about this morning, that Hunter Dean has been in the hospital for a while. He has colon cancer. It took a turn this week. He was put into the ICU and is on a ventilator this morning. We have others in our congregation that are dealing with cancer, but hold up the Dean family. Hold up all of those who are sick, who are hurting, we're bound. Today we find release and we find comfort and we find grace at the altar of our Lord. I'm going to invite Krista to come and lead us in prayer this morning.
Let's pray. Oh God, we come into your presence this morning and we humble ourselves before you. Just because you are God. You are holy. You are mighty. Your power is beyond any comprehend. Your grace overflows abundantly. The depths of your love we can never reach. You are God. Mm-hmm. And we are humbled that you have even graced us with your presence this morning. We come into this place longing, seeking you, seeking the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, just a glimpse of you. And you've come this morning, and this creator of the universe, the God who is everywhere, who fills every space in this universe, has dared to grace our presence this morning and stop to be with us. God, that's mind-blowing. That is beyond anything I could completely comprehend, anything I could ever understand, that this God of the universe would want to have an audience with us.
Thank you.
But that's exactly what you've done this morning, and I'm incredibly thankful that you've chosen to enter this space this morning. And God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would flow. I pray that your Holy Spirit would come and it would move and it would be powerful and it would be mighty, and that you would whisper in the ears of the people in this space how much you love them and how you're moving in their lives. God, I know one thing for sure, that you are always moving on our behalf. I know that because your scripture tells us that, and your promises are true, and you have never ever once broken one of those promises, and you are moving. And God, some weeks it's so evident, and God, this week for me, thinking of our teens in Florida, it's been so amazing to hear the reports of what you're doing and how you are flowing and your spirit is moving in their lives, and you're changing them and you're transforming them and you're making them more like you, and you're calling them to something greater. And God, it has been an amazing week for me. It has been an amazing week for me to see and know that you are God and experience it. But God, I know there are others that are sitting in the sanctuary that would say to me, oh, Krista, I didn't sense his presence this week. It was a hard week.
Yes, God.
And so, God, I pray for each one of those that you would go to them and you would comfort them and you would give them peace, but most importantly, that they would be reminded that you are a God who is on the move. Yes. You are working on their behalf and you have not stopped. That in the shadows, in the places that they cannot see, you are moving. God, remind us that you are a God who heals. And you are a God who redeems. And you are a God who wants our lives to flourish. You have not left us. You are with us. God, remind us that the power that raised Jesus from the dead is the power that gets to live inside of us. Because in a miraculous way that is so mysterious that I could never understand, your Holy Spirit lives in us. God, we lift up Hunter today. God, would you touch his body? Would you heal him? We trust you with him, God. Pray for his family. Pray for their comfort and their peace. God, I think of the others. I think of Muncie, and I think of the others in our congregation that are going through and need your healing touch, God. We need you today. God, I thank you that you are on the move. I thank you that you are the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I thank you that you have not left us. You have not forsaken us.
Yes, God.
And God, I thank you that you have a word for us today. I pray that you would open our hearts to hear from you. I pray for your overflow to come, that we might live in your abundance today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Praise be to God for his Spirit among us this day. We're going to be in Matthew's Gospel. Two words this morning. Usually at this time, I invite the children to run away. That is not happening today. We are having Family Sunday. Our youth pastor is in the air, our children's pastor is flying right now back home, where he will be here tomorrow to take our kids off to tween camp. So children, you're welcome, and I'm sorry for staying in town, staying in the service. The other thing I need to address is probably my appearance. I know you're all thinking, why are you waiting after a year for doing that? But I am wearing a bow tie this morning. I want to tell you the story of why I am wearing a bow tie. I did not always wear bow ties. I came to be a pastor at a time when pastors were expected to wear coat and ties to church. And I did that faithfully for year after year after year. And then I started noticing that fewer and fewer people, the congregation before me, maybe you are joining us online and you are wearing a tie, which thank you. God appreciates it, I'm sure. The congregation before me stopped wearing ties to church. And so I kind of wanted to make sure that I mirrored them and kind of, you know, make sure we're all together on the same page. About that same time where I was starting to come to this come to Jesus moment and stopping wearing ties every Sunday, I was also teaching at a school. I was teaching, and my students there thought it would be good for me as their teacher to have a bow tie. And so they gave me my very first bow tie, this bow tie, actually. And I noticed something when one Sunday, I just didn't wear the long tie, wore a bow tie, and everyone smiled at me. And that wasn't what normally happens when they see the pastor. Usually it is not smiles. But this day it was smiles, and I was like, I noticed that. And so I started wearing a bow tie every once in a while. I would sprinkle it through the day, through the year, just to bring a little bit of sunshine and joy to a dour and stern congregation. Not that you all are that. So you see the trajectories of my life. Eventually, I wanted to have just a month where we wore bow ties the whole time. Therefore, was born Bow Tie July. And I would wear a bow tie throughout the month of July as a blessing to the congregation. Those faithful who endure the storms, who brave the heat, who show up when everyone else is on vacation to church. I wanted to give you something to look forward to. And I wanted to encourage you out there in congregation land that you too can go and get bow ties. And you can wear them to church in this month. There will be no shame. There will be no condemnation. There will only be joy and light and smiles. So, bow tie July. Feel free to wear your bow ties for the next few months. I forgot last week. Ian represented. I'm wearing one this week. Ian's not here. We'll come together eventually and have a bow tie celebration. That has nothing to do with the sermon whatsoever. There should be a good transition here, but there is not. We are going to read from Matthew chapter 11, beginning in the 16th verse. Hear now the word of the Lord. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace, calling out to one another, "We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they said, 'Look, a glutton and a drunkard and a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." Skip down with me to verse 25. At that time, let me say that again. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and no one knows the Father except through the Son, and anyone whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It's a dangerous question to ask at the beginning of a sermon, but I'm going to ask it anyway and hope that you do not immediately check out. You ready? What time is it? Yep, see, I saw a few of you lean down. You distracted already. What time is it? You don't have to tell me. You don't shout it out, though we should practice saying amen, because I'm going to need your help this morning. How do you know what time it is? You look at your watch and it tells you, assuming you said it correctly. You look at your phone and trust that Steve Jobs from behind the grave is still updating those devices. How do you know? Early in my first marriage, my young bride and I had a disagreement over clocks. I guess I should pause there and say, technically, I am still in my first marriage, but I'm still preaching, so. The whole wedding registry is an invitation for discourse and conflict. It is a crucible of arguments and fightings that our society has deemed all young, foolish lovers must pass through. So there we were, about to get married, and we were registering for pots and pans and plates and toasters and toiletries. Back then, I don't know how they do it now, but back then you would go to the store and you would fill out some paperwork or do something on a computer screen, and they would hand you a scanner gun. And you would proceed to make your way through the lawless aisles of that big box stores and pick out what you like. You would think and talk, and if you were marrying me, you would fight and argue and eventually cry because I am an obstinate and stubborn man. We needed clocks in our house, we decided, and we were at Target. Scanner in hand, and there we were in the clock section, my young bride, my first wife. She set her eyes on something nice and understated. It was a round quartz clock with a wood trim and a nice clear white dial. I, on the other hand, had found a far superior clock. It was square, and it was digital. It not only told you the time, but the date and the temperature in the room you were in, just so you know. But what truly made this clock great was that it was an atomic clock. I had heard rumors of this before. I think I had a friend in seminary who had one and would speak of its glory. You see, beloved, and I'm about to drop a truth bomb on you that will change some of your lives. You do not have to set an atomic clock. I thought that was going to get a little bit more of a response. I guess in my mind, setting a clock is a burden that many of us carry. I was trying to release you from that burden, but we'll keep going on. These atomic clocks possess some kind of magical power or voodoo or fairy dust or whatever it is, because once you put it on the wall, you can set it and forget it. You don't even have to set it. You just knows the time. The story I'm going to make up right now is that in Colorado, there is an atomic clock that uses something called isometric isotope, something I just made up. And they use that to measure time, and they beam that measurement out across all of the atomic clocks in the Western Hemisphere, and somehow it is right. This is what I'm reading on the back of the clock there in Target as I'm ready to scan it while we are having a fight and disagreeing over what clock we should hang in our house. We registered for 2 clocks that day. We received 2 clocks that day, which you would think would fix the problem, but it only exacerbated things. And so for the next few houses, every time we moved, we would have a fight over where the good clock would go. By good, I clearly mean my clock. We would fight over where the pretty one went or where the accurate one went. So I ask you, church, how do you know the time? There's a lot going on in this section of Matthew's gospel. Following closely on the heels of John the Baptist, Jesus, the great and final prophet of Israel, has come on the scene to declare the coming of God's kingdom. And as he begins to preach and teach the people, great crowds begin to follow him around. And out of that great crowd, he selects a few disciples, a few followers, some fisher folks, some tax collectors, some other social reprobates. And after teaching them throughout chapter 10, he sends out those disciples into the villages and towns of Israel to spread his message. He sends them out as sheep amongst wolves. And while they are away, Jesus continues to do his work. He continues to teach about the kingdom of God come to earth. Around about this time, John the Baptist was put in prison. He had gotten involved into a little political scandal. I don't know if you knew this, but political powers do not like being challenged. And John had gotten on the wrong side of people in authority. And they send him to jail. And from his jail cell, he sends Jesus a question. Are you the one? It's a loaded question. It can reveal whatever you want it to reveal. Perhaps John was in a low place there in the prison. Perhaps John was second-guessing his cousin. Perhaps John was looking over at his situation and reading the tea leaves of divine kingdom and saying there's something else going on. Whatever the reason, he sends this question to his cousin. Now, there could scarcely be 2 different cousins. In the world. I want you to think of your cousin, your crazy cousin, the cousin you don't talk to, the cousin that you've blocked on Facebook. That's kind of how Jesus and John were. You had John, the bug-eating prophet living in the wilderness. You had Jesus, the guy who loved a good meal and had all kinds of company, usually the wrong kind of company around him. You had John who's out there wearing scratchy shirts on purpose to express his piety and his serious contrition. And you have Jesus who kind of liked to party. Jesus who could be persuaded to invoke the power of God so that the wedding doesn't run out of wine. You have John who shows up and finds an audience and begins to lay in them, addresses them as broods of vipers. And you have Jesus who shows up and finds all sorts of compliments and blessings to a bunch of nobodies. Both men are powerful prophets. One is dour and stern-faced. The other likes to party a little too much. But each of them come to the people of Israel. Each of them preach. Each of them try to tell them what time it is. And each of them don't get responses that they like from the people. Chapter 11, verse 16, it's almost as if Jesus is throwing up his hands, saying, what in the world am I going to do with this group of people? This people who have surrounded me, who are listening to this, my sermons, they just can't be happy. They just can't be content. I don't want anybody looking around at your neighbors, because there are certain folks who cannot be happy. I know, because I am one of them. Eeyore is my spirit animal. This generation, Jesus says, is filled with people who just can't be content, who are never quite settled. They call out for the flute to be played, but they do not dance. They wail, and they do not mourn. Flutes at this time were an instrument for weddings. The places that our Lord grew up weren't exactly cradles of luxury, but yet they still, in their poverty, in their ignorance, they knew how to throw a good party. And so when you were in the marketplace doing your shopping and you heard the flute echoing through the corridors, you knew that somebody was having a good time. And there was an implicit invitation for everyone who heard the sound of the flute to join in the merriment, to begin to dance and celebrate. The same thing happened at funerals. Back then, they had professional mourners. We have professional complainers. They had professional mourners, people who would come along the mourning parade and the funeral service and would cry out and wail so that everyone knew what was happening in front of them. The whole community was invited together. This generation, the generation surrounding John and Jesus, they played the flute, but John refused to dance. That they came to him with their expectations and their needs, their wants and desires, and John refused to play their games. But not just John, Jesus too was out of sync. They wanted Jesus to conform to their expectations. They invited Jesus to come for them and mourn with them. They wailed and he refused. Because this people, they didn't know what time it was. It's a tricky thing, time. Just a few months ago, I moved from Eastern Standard Time to Central Standard Time. And for those who have lived in Central Time for a while, you have become accustomed to the malformation that is this time zone. I'm kidding. I think I like it better. But it is a little different. Our news here starts at 4 instead of God's appointed hour of 5. Whenever you see a sporting event that's going to be broadcast, you have to do a little bit of math that causes me pain to figure out when to tune in or else you will miss it. The sun rises earlier here than it does on the East Coast. It's tricky. And it's a tricky thing to know the time. Life gets in the way with all the things that are competing for your attention. Your job and your spouse and your parents and your kids and your friends and your church and vacation and sleep and shopping and chores, all clamoring upon you for that same 168 hours you have each and every week. And sometimes in the hustle and bustle of life, we can forget what time it is. And then Matthew subtly says, at that time. At the time when the people were confused, at the time when they were missing out on the kingdom around them, at the time when they were flustered by the Messiah that refused to meet their expectations, at the time when they were worried or anxious, at the time when their jobs dried up and the doctors weren't sure, at that time Jesus stood up and he says, I have come to reveal the Father. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. And no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and who the Son reveals that to. You want to know what time it is? Don't look on your watches. Don't go to your phones. Don't look at the wall. Look at Jesus. Are you distracted and confused by all of the things that clamor for your attention? Look to Jesus. Are you in that place of uncertainty and anxiousness about your future? Look to Jesus. Are you weighed down by past mistakes and imprisoned by regret? Look to Jesus, because Jesus reveals to us who God is. Amen. Thank you. Call it out louder. We got to do some Christology this morning. No amens that? Okay. We'll keep going. Sometimes it takes us a while. We who are wise and intelligent, it takes us a while to figure things out. Of course, according to verse 25, that may be by design. It took the church 300 years to figure out who Jesus was. 300 years of wrestling and fighting and debating and arguing, occasional punch thrown, occasional splinter group, some genocide thrown in every once in a while, but not often. 300 years to figure out what Jesus was. And what we finally figured out was simply Jesus was fully God. 300 years to get that sentence. Jesus was fully God. He was the full incarnation, the full enfleshment of the divine life. Everything that God was, everything that God is, everything that God will be, all of God's power and His holiness and His wisdom and His mercy and His grace and His faithfulness, all of His love are included in who the Son is. They are united in the divine life. But they are not the same. In fact, they are very, very different. They are as different as you are from your father. Somebody should say amen. They are as different as you are from your mother. They are more different than anything in the world you can imagine, but their difference, the difference between the Father and the Son, is not an obstacle. It is not a hindrance. It is not unlike us. It doesn't trip God up and get God in trouble. That difference is always the beautiful difference of harmony. You know, we have some great singers in our church. And something happens when you are carrying a note as a voice and another voice joins you, not the same note, but a different note that matches. The wavelengths sync together, and all of a sudden the two voices are singing harmony greater than the sum of the parts. That is the divine life sung out as the Father sings to the Son, and the Son returns that song in the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus tells us that everything the Father is has been revealed to the Son. The Nicene Creed puts it this way: the Son is the only begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. The Creed tells us that all things were made through the Son. Jesus was the avenue. Jesus was the catalyst. Jesus was the tool that God uses to create the universe. It is Jesus that threw the stars in the sky and carved the mountains into the hills. Jesus is the way to the Father. We silly little human beings that we are, we're one of those things that were made by Jesus. We were only, therefore, have access to the Father through the Son. And so we go to the Son who brings us, who admits us into the presence of the Father. And with us, we take all the things that weigh us down, all of our troubles and confusions and distractions and pettiness and hurts and wounds. We come to Jesus and we say, I don't know what time it is, but I've got all this junk in my life that weighs on me, and I need you to do something about it. And Jesus says, I got this. Jesus says, this is why I came, to reveal the Father. And what you need to know about the Father, what Jesus shows us about the Father, is that our God is not a God of judgment or condemnation. This is not a God that is looking out to get you and beat you down. This is not a God who keeps track of your failures and faults. This is not a God who is trying to pile it on you and add one more expectation that you can't meet, one more deadline that you're going to miss, one more to-do that you're not going to make it. This is the God who came to give you rest. Come to me, Jesus says. All you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. I read a quote this week that Jesus is always more present in times of need than in times of plenty. Jesus is always more present in times of desperation than in times of certainty. Jesus has this habit of showing up in our lives in the moment when we are undone and incomplete and at the end of our rope and uncertain about where to go. Jesus comes when we don't know the time. There's a bishop in Alabama a few years ago. He had this great line. He said, "I don't think our age is going to be known as the age of freedom, but the age of anxiety." That's truth. That is truth. We are anxious people about so many things. Going to have enough money? Am I going to eat well enough to live the next day? Am I going to be secure? Am I going to be safe? Are my parents going to make it? Are my kids going to make it? What does the future hold? And all of these questions, all of that anxiety, it starts to pile up and push down. And Jesus doesn't come to give you one more thing to put on your back and bear. Jesus comes and says, "Give to me. Give me that which is pushing you down and weighing on your soul. Give to me that thing that is piling up and causing you to worry. Give to me, and you know what I'm going to give you back is rest. My yoke is easy." Who here thought about yokes as egg yolks? Anybody? Thank you. Thank you. I see those hands. This is not an egg yolk. A yoke in this situation was a large, heavy piece of wood that they would put on the back of animals to get them to go the right way. You would yoke a team of oxen or a team of horse so that you could plow a field. You would yoke a beast of burden so that they could pull your stuff. You would yoke them so that they could work together. Here's the thing. Jesus says that his yoke, this heavy piece of wood, it's easy. The Greek here is actually the word kind. A kind yoke is one that fits you. A kind yoke is one that doesn't rub and chafe. A kind yoke is one that, yes, is heavy, but it pushes you to the direction you need to go so that you are bound up with others and working together. A kind yoke rests upon you and blocks out all of the other distractions. The rest of Jesus is the work of the normal life transformed and remade. It is the invitation of God not to take away the things that you can't bear, but to come alongside you and to bear them with you. This morning, are you tired? Sometimes I am. This morning, are you carrying something heavy? This morning, are your knees weak and your back sore and your head bent low and your shoulders pushed down? This morning, is your soul weighed down? Today is the time for you to set that aside. Today is the time for you to leave whatever burden you are carrying, whatever weight is pressing down upon you. Today is the day for you to find rest. And here's the thing, you don't have to do. It's not one more thing. You don't have to try. You don't have to measure up. You just have to come. Come to me, all you who are weary, and I will give you rest.